Welcome to the ninth session of CPS Talks with Authors, to our presenters, to our discussant, and to everyone who have joined us. This seminar is co-organized by the Research Committee on Political Sociology and our Faculty of Education and Social Sciences at Andres Bello University. It is also sponsored by the International Sociological Association and the International Political Science Association, by the Vice Rectory for Research of Andres Bello University and the Global Network of Women Political Scientists. Today we are honored to have Giulia Sandri and Patricia Correa with us. Giulia is professor in political science at Université Catholique de Lille. She's also an expert on digital politics, party politics, quality of democracy and political behavior. Patricia is a lecturer in politics and international relations at Aston University, Birmingham, and does research in comparative politics, federalism, and intergovernmental relations, and political organizations and parties. Both will present their fascinating book, Digital Parties, The Challenges of Online Organization and Participation, published by Springer in 2021, a book which deals about how parties enter the digital world, particularly the new ones. The presentation will then be commented by Karina Kosiara-Pedersen, who is professor of political science at the Department of Political Science at the University of Copenhagen, and she's also a member of CPS board. Thanks to the three of you for having accepted our invitation. We'll have two presentations from Giulia and Patricia of about 15 minutes, followed by Karina's comments for another 15 minutes. Then the discussion will be open to the public. I think Giulia will start. So Giulia, I'll leave you the floor.
Yeah, thank you. I will just show you my presentation. If this is working, yes. Okay, is everything working fine? Good.
Yes.
Perfect. So the book deals with the transition into the digital era of contemporary political parties. We mostly focus on European parties, but as you can see, if you read the book, we also try to explore what's going on outside Europe, and in particular, we cover a few cases in Japan. Try to do in this book. We try to take stock of what the scholarly literature has already analyzed, understood, try to conceptualize about the digitalization of political organizations in general and political parties in particular. We try to identify the main challenges of transitioning into the digital world of contemporary parties, but trying to go beyond the three main trends in contemporary studies on digitalization of political parties. So what more or less we know already is how the digitalization of political parties impact on political campaigning, on political communication, on internal information flows, and so on within parties, and how all these impact on participation in general. There's a huge literature on that, and we try to build on that literature. What we also try to do is to go beyond the debate between cyber optimists and cyber pessimists. So we try to avoid going into conclusions on what's going to happen next, what is best for an effective process of digitalization. We try just to map the situation as per 2020. Actually, you will see in the book has been written pre-pandemic. So most of the chapters has been written between 2019 and very early 2020. So that's maybe the topic for the next book, try to see how this process has been accelerated by the pandemic. And we try also to go beyond the creation of new party categories like the cyber party, the connective parties, the platform party, the networker parties. This is very useful literature, very useful models for understanding party change and party evolution, especially in Europe. But we try to go beyond that, beyond the application to empirical cases of theoretical models to really measure the process of digitalization of political parties. And in particular, we try to focus on internal organization. So mostly the main research question we try to explore in the book is to what extent, how do digital technologies shape parties' internal organization, so the internal distribution of power, intra-party democracy, and functions of party organizational structures. So, in particular, we start from the view that digitalization is conceptualized in the book as a process. It's not the application of ideal typical model to reality, to empirical reality, but rather to try to map this process and to see how this happens in reality in different party cases. So what we try to measure in the end is the degree of digitalization in contemporary parties and to try to identify patterns of digitalization across party families, across different party age, different party also context in different countries, at national, at subnational level, and so on. So most of the book revolves around two research questions that stem from the main one I was mentioning before. First one, how are new technologies influencing intra-party democracy and internal distribution of power? So really how these affect internal organization, especially in terms of power relations. Is digitalization fostering new hierarchies? Is digitalization strengthening the elites? Is digitalization strengthening the power of members of the grassroots? What's happening in reality? And we try also to see to what extent digitalization affects the different moments, the different steps of the party life cycle. Does digitalization allow for institutionalization of new parties that are digitally native? What's the impact on party change in general? And we try to apply an innovative framework, which is called the five-pillar model, which is conceptualized by Jasmine Fitzpatrick in the book. And the idea is to look at five different pillars of internal organization settings and to see to what extent they are digitalized in different parties that are selected in our sample. So we look at digitalization of party membership and recruitment, of internal decision-making, of resources, of communication, and policy decisions, and public policy or policy decisions and policy-making. Of course, we try also to outline as much as possible the regulatory issues that can arise concerning the digitalization process in those pillars and in general. And the final goal is really to map the digitalization process in the selected cases and try to find patterns that can be useful for analyzing the consequences of the process. And as you can see from my last PowerPoint slide, we selected cases both in Southern Europe, so from Spain, from Italy, from Portugal, but also from Eastern Europe, for example, from Czech Republic, but also Northern Europe, from Finland, the UK, Germany, and also, as you can see on the top right hand of the PowerPoint slide, a couple of cases from Japan, just to see how this kind of process is developing outside the European context. And I'll give now the floor to Patricia, who's going to outline the results of the findings of our book. Thank you.
I was muted. Can you see the slides? I cannot see you if I have the slides on, so yes, okay. Good, so I'm going to try to summarize the findings of the book. And this is, as Giulia says, so this is a collective effort, and this is the result of, it started with a workshop and has been the work that we've been doing in the past, a couple of years before the pandemic. So most of the findings talk about how the parties were before the pandemic and how they developed their digital organizations. So the general goals of the book were to try to provide an original account of the digitalization of political parties. So we wanted to have a look about how different political parties, both new and traditional or mainstream parties, were digitalizing their organizations, if they were doing it, and to what extent they were doing it, what elements of the organizational life were happening online. And we wanted to assess how the development of the party platforms was happening across different types of political parties, which will allow us to identify some trade-offs, some problems or challenges that come through linked to the digitalization process. So I'm just going to summarize some of the findings. I will give an overview, but I won't go with a lot of details. So for that, you will have to buy the book and read it. But I think one of the key findings that I want to highlight today is the fact that all political parties digitalize to some extent their organizations. So this is not a thing or a phenomenon that only affects new parties or parties like the pirate parties. This is something that all political parties are dealing with right now. There is no unique pattern of digitalization. So that means that not all political parties are going to digitalize in the same way. They are not going to transfer their offline organization to the digital world to the same extent. They will have different priorities in what they have available on their online platforms and what remains as part of their offline organization. And they are not going to do it at the same speed. So we have cases in the book that they pretty much build up their organization digitally. So they already started as a kind of like having a digital organization pretty much or working in. And then we have other cases that they have slowly introduced different elements of their, they have slowly moved different elements of their organization to their online platform. And this is also going to mean that the trade-offs that are often associated to digitalization will have a different impact on different political parties. And for the same reason, different types of parties will have or will face different constraints to digitalize different elements of their organization. So for instance, new organizations that they have to build the organization from scratch might face less resistance from their members to move everything online, while more established organizations that are functioning mainly offline might face some resistance from some members to move certain aspects to the digital world. So we have to think about patterns of digitalization. As I said before, there is not a unique pattern of how this process happens, and also there is not a unique way in which political parties understand digitalization. So what we observe is that mainstream parties have tended to embrace digitalization as an additional tool. So creating these platforms allows them to have a new tool to communicate with their members or to communicate and disseminate their own ideas, to enhance their recruitment or to manage or engage with their members and manage things as, for instance, membership fees or donations or things like that. We have also observed how some new parties, are more likely to think about digitalization as an essential part of their organization. So that will be part of their organizational essence. It will be a defining trait of their organization. They have a fully functioning platform that allows for a lot of member engagement. What we are observing is that it seems to be an incremental digitalization trend, meaning that all political parties are, or most of them are, increasing the extent of functions that are moved to the digital platforms. So a lot of the parties that started using their platforms mainly for communication purposes have started to increasing towards maybe decision-making procedures or policy-making decisions. So they have amplified the widen on the number of functions that are also part of their online platforms. And that made us think this incremental digitalization trend suggests that maybe these differences that we are observing right now between mainstream and new parties will decrease over time. We thought, or one of the, I don't want to say hypothesis, but maybe one of the assumptions or expectations that we had was the fact that maybe ideology played a role in the level of digitalization of different political parties. And we did that building on the assumption that it's often, you can find often in political parties works that left-wing parties tend to be more likely to care about participatory aspects or to improve the levels of participation or engagement of their members. And maybe through digitalization, they had a good opportunity to create these options for their members to participate, and by that they will be more likely to digitalize or to digitalize to a wider extent their organizations. But we also observe that there are a lot, while we find that in left and regional parties, we also find it in new parties from center-right. So that made us think that maybe ideology wasn't necessarily the, one of the main drivers of digitalization, and the fact that we also find a lot of heterogeneity within parties on the same spectrum, like within the left spectrum, for instance, also suggests that maybe ideology is not one of the explanatory factors to try to understand why political parties will digitalize to a particular extent. As Giulia mentioned, so we built from the different chapters go or try to explain how platforms work and the different organizational aspects that are developed in those platforms. And we do it by using the five-pillar model that embeds different aspects of the organization. So I'm trying to summarize a bit of the information, and I won't go in a lot of detail of everything because I could be talking for hours. But just to give you an idea, when we talk about the public image and the platforms used, we focus especially on the online participation platforms. So that will be like within the websites of the political parties, the platforms that they create that allow for member or user interaction. And there are some problems that are associated with the creation or with how these platforms are developed. And one of them, very simple, is in terms of access. So who can access to the different features that are developed within the platforms? And we have observed that some parties that in their origin were maybe more generous in terms of access have decided to become more restrictive later on, or the other way around. Some parties that were a little bit maybe more restrictive in the beginning have become more flexible in who they allow access to these platforms and to use the different features within the platforms. Some of the problems that might be associated is also about the type of information that is available on those platforms, and that has to do with the quantity, so how much information is finally put or made available in those platforms, and the quality of the information. There are questions about the affordances, so what actually the platform that you have allow you to do. So what type of, how it can be used by the parties will depend a lot on the type of platform that is built, the software, but also who owns the platform and the chances that you have to make changes and improvements of that platform a long time, depending on the different types of problems that you might face or the different use that you want to make from that platform. And some of the positive sides or effects of political parties building those platforms have to do in terms of transparency. This is a great opportunity for parties to become more transparent, not only toward their members, but also to the wider population. It allows them for them to, for instance, publish their own budget, how they spend the money or the resources and things like that. It could be used positively if we have a look at how the chapter that works on the green parties in German. We can see an example of positive experiences of how these platforms can be used to make party elites more responsive or to hold them accountable of the different decisions, but they are not necessarily working into favor of accountability or responsiveness. And we also observe some how in some cases political parties were not that successful to use them in that way. There could be also issues of security, and that is, like, if you have a look, there are several chapters in the book that talk about the Five Star Movement, who has their platform is owned by an independent partner, so, and that has brought some issues for the organization of the party. One of the, one of the main areas in which political parties have digitalized is when it has to do with dealing with issues linked to the membership. Anything that has to do about communication information, recruiting new members, or even some political parties have created new types of membership that are fully digital. And all of that is done through these party platforms. Some of the political parties, again, have been very careful and thorough when it comes to create different opportunities for their members to participate in their digital platforms, and they have taken into account the potential inequalities that might be generated through this online organization that maybe are not present in the offline organization. But this is, again, not the case for all of the parties. While some parties pay attention to this, this is sometimes ignored in other political parties. So, for instance, the German Pirates will assume that just because of the fact that maybe this is like an online organization, it allows everyone that wants to engage to participate, while other parties like the Green Party will be more careful to take into account that the digital world might already be a barrier for certain type of individuals. There is also this debate linked to the membership that makes you think, to what extent are we empowering our members by allowing them to participate, to decide in a lot of party decisions like candidate selection or even policy making decisions, or we are just creating this kind of pseudo-participation that is associated with the image that will make you think you are engaging and you are participating, but the way that the participation process has been designed, the rules or the topics that are actually discussed have been already decided. And this is just an example of an internal referendum that gives you the idea or the view that you participated, but the decision was already taken already before. And this has to do also with the quality of the deliberative process that the political parties have put in place in their party platforms, and how those platforms allow their members to actually engage in this deliberation with a certain level of quality of discussion, or this is not possible. And while political parties might benefit from dealing with membership issues when it online, and the fact that, for instance, having an assessment of the actual number of members could be easy, or communicating relevant or controlling the party fees and stuff like that can be done very efficiently through online, and maybe more efficiently than as it is done at the local or the different offline organizations. But there is also create these problems of having this blur of last membership or having these moments of very active participation at particular points where key topics are decided, but then having a very passive membership. And this is something that maybe is easier to cultivate offline than online, and political parties have dealt with these issues in a different way. Some of them have put more attention and have tried to cultivate also their offline organization, while others have intentionally cultivate an online member state that allows maybe for more control of outputs or things like that. And this goes in line with the traditional debate in people that study intra-party democracy with customers saying about how this could disempower middle-level elites and these type of things linked to intra-party democracy. So when it comes to decision-making and powers, most of the platforms allow for voting different types of decisions. So there will be key strategic decisions, for instance, maybe if they go into a coalition with certain political parties or not for government, or certain positions for relevant issues at particular times. And then they can also use the platforms to vote in their candidate and leadership selection processes. But there are some problems with that not all political parties are taking into account. And those are the ones that had to do with the technical standards of how this i-voting works, but also the democratic standards and the potential threats of security, or just controlling for aspects that are simple as that we can be sure that people only vote once and we don't have a party member voting four times and things like that. And there are issues thinking linked to who has the control for agenda setting, so who has the capacity to design how the e-voting will take place, what are the rules, but also what topics will end up being discussed or voted, and with what other topics will never be put up to discussion online. And the consequences, depending on the outcomes and how these rules or how these standards are implemented, is that the level of empowerment of the party members will be higher or lower, or the results of those procedures will enhance even more this kind of like hyper leadership or this trend towards more publicitarian type of decisions and lower accountability of the party elites. At the same way, all of these type of decisions, everything that has to do with membership, with decision making, and in the next slide I talk about policy making, are going to impact the level of organizational stability. And depending on the level of institutionalization or the level of instability of the organization, political parties will be in a better position to face the consequences of moving their offline organization to the online platform, while other parties might be even putting their organizations into further stress just by doing this move from the offline world to the online world. Finally, so very similar to some of the aspects I have mentioned in the other pillars or the other areas, is the relevance about how do you ensure that when it comes to deciding about policy making or drafting new policies or political positions, you ensure that their deliberation takes place and that there are clear rules of how it works and how you can work towards consensus building, or how this is going to generate more dissent and the potential issues within increasing the levels of internal conflict or decreasing the levels of internal conflict within the political party, and how this might play as a, just a simple mechanism to add legitimacy to decisions that have already been taken, or that actually discuss and create, and the drafts are done by different party members. Well, this is a great opportunity for members from different regions, for instance. So the one, I'm from Spain, so this will allow that someone from Valencia can discuss a new national draft with someone from Asturias, for instance. There are also some issues that depend on how the rules and how the system is set up will make that process more difficult or won't allow them to engage or to amend as many things as they might want to, or that may be able in an offline discussion at the party local headquarters. And that's one of the consequences, to what extent this is limiting internal debate within the party organizations. So if I had to talk about very briefly the main conclusions, and I also have some open questions that we can discuss about, but the main conclusions from my point of view is the fact that all parties have digitalized their organizations to some extent. This is something that is here to stay, and we're going to see more and more probably elements of the typical day-to-day life of the political parties move to their online world. It's also that building a digital organization provides new opportunities for member of empowerment, but depending on the setup, this level of empowerment will vary a lot, creating this kind of like pseudo participation, making it even more present than it was before or not. So it will depend, not just because parties have digitalized, the result will be an immediate or a certain level of member empowerment. It will depend on how they do it. And that has to do with my next point, that digitalization doesn't necessarily has only positive consequences, that there are problems associated with it and parties need to reflect on, but not all parties are taking the same level of attention to the potential consequences or trade-offs of actually digitalizing their organizations. And this brings me to some open questions that I think we will have time to discuss, or that is going to also be relevant for future research or on this area. And it's like the debate about if parties can afford not to digitalize, what factors might explain the differences in the levels of digitalization that we are already observing. So we already know that there might be a divide between traditional and new parties, but maybe there are other factors like contextual factors that we haven't explored that might be relevant. When we think about digitalization of the party organizations, we also think about the role that party members will have. So it might be interesting to think which members are going to benefit most from this digitalization. And to a more maybe higher level is to what extent digitalization is going to help political parties to perform their traditional functions, for instance, in terms of linkages. And with this, I finish. I'm going to stop sharing now. Let's see if I'm on it.
Thanks a lot. Yeah. Patricia, for this presentation, and also to Giulia. And now, Karina, I leave you the floor.
Thank you. And thank you to Giulia and Patricia, both for the presentations here and for being part of the splendid team doing a very important and timely book. I think it's great that you have collected this in one volume, and of course I'll be asking you for more, but just to make sure that it's really nice that you that you've done this and put all these various perspectives together. So in the book and also in your presentation, you you present these various aspects of digitalization of parties. But I think in the book, both in the framework, the five pillars, and in the final chapter, that you're also able to collect this and make it a coherent piece. So I think that's very nice and in person. It's impressive for us party scholars and those interested in digitalization, of course. I have a couple of questions, and at the individual level, organization level, and system level, and I think we'll start out at the organizational level because that much of the focus in the book is on this. And Patricia has sort of addressed this in the presentation of the results, namely that it depends a little bit on how parties do it. In your question on can they afford not to digitalize it, et cetera. Because I'm thinking about I'm a little gray haired, so I'm thinking back to the 90s when I was formed as a party scholar, and the whole discussion of party change, party decline, and all that. The Katzenmayer came out with the Cargill Party article, and back then we discussed, the party scholars discussed how party change happened. And that's why my first question to you is sort of like, is digitalization a tool for the dominant coalition or force in itself? And you're addressing it in different ways in the book. And to give an example that lies close to my heart and that you also mentioned. So is blurring the blurring of the distinction between members and other party supporters, is that driving the use of digital tools, or is it the other way around? So that digital tools is driving this blurring because parties cannot not do it. So I'm thinking, to what extent is digitalization something that's enforced upon parties? And to what extent is this something that the party leadership, the dominant coalition, whoever is, you know, on top of things, use digitalization to make the changes that they want or that empower them? And I'm thinking about Patricia, when you mentioned, and also it's in the book, but you know, the difference between new and old parties and the importance of ideology. You know, if a mainstream party has the resources for a very top-notch platform for member engagement, and they emphasize participatory democracy in their ideology, let's say that the party is a little bit left of center, maybe they're, you know, keen on digitalization, but if they don't have any money, or if they're not so keen on participatory democracy, let's say they're a little bit to the right of center, maybe they're not, you know, as keen on it. So I'm thinking a lot of, you know, resources, power, all that. So that would be, I don't know whether it's a question or not, let's put a question mark. So is digitalization driving these changes, or is digitalization used more as a tool?
Can we reply already?
No, yeah.
Okay, I'm going to jump in, and then I think this is the question that also might divide scholars on digitalization. To me, more with the hat of a party scholar, I think it's a tool that political parties have at their own disposal and that they might use differently. But I think that I also agree in terms of resources, and that's interesting. And I think, if I remember correctly, in the chapter on the focus on the pilot on the German Greens, they if I remember correctly, the Greens develop themselves their own software, and then I think the pilots have done it. So then maybe if it was costly at the beginning, they don't have the troubles that other parties that have externalized and function might have in terms of resources, and they also have much more control of what use they made of the platform later on, which has a lot to do in terms of power and how the organizations use the tools to their own advantage. In the case of the Greens, one of the goals was to try to ensure there were not many inequalities or participatory gaps, but other political parties could use it to be sure that they control what has been decided within the organization digitally. And I stop because maybe Giulia wants to add something.
Yeah, I just wanted to add a quick point, in the sense that both in the book and in further work we're doing, building on the book right now, especially from some other colleagues that were not in the initial books, like Fabio Garcia Lupato, for example, and Oscar Barbera, who could not join us today, but you know Oscar, we try to map even more systematically the digitalization of parties, what we've seen on this new data set, but also in the book already, is that if we take all the different indicators of digitalization together, so if we look at, let's say, a cumulative index of digitalization, taking into account internet voting or digital voting for candidates, or a specific platform for internal debate and maybe legislative act proposals and so on, overall, older traditional parties are more digitalized than new ones. So the type of digitalization of new digitally native party might be more, let's say, flashy or more used as a specific feature for the party to be recognized, to be labeled, to be selected by voters as the new digital party. But actually, if we look at really the overall degree of digitalization of parties, the bigger, older, more traditional parties are catching up quite quickly. We don't have proof so far, but intuitively my explanation would be because they have the funds to do this and to do it in a way that is more effective. In this case, so I agree with Patricia, in this view, the idea is that digitalization is more of a tool that is better or more effectively used by bigger traditional parties that have more know-how, have easier access to companies or external providers that do so, that can build a nice, effective platform for them, and have also the funding to do so. So it might be more visible in some new parties, but actually overall, it's working as a tool, mostly developed by the party elites for the dominant coalition in bigger traditional parties. Thank you.
I can add.
Patricia.
Just very quick, and it goes in line with what Giulia was just saying, and it's the idea that can parties afford not to digitalize, and I think that's going to have to be related with the party competition or the party system in which they are embedded in. So in some cases, so we will see how it, maybe were new parties, the ones that have started giving relevance to this online presence and developing their organizations, and they forced traditional parties to catch up. They had to do it if they want to look at they were close to the borders, if they want to strengthen this linkage, even if we need to see how they use it later on. But just as in terms of public image, that was important for them to do it. And then in that scenario, they cannot afford not digitalizing. But maybe in other contexts in which that is not that relevant, they can survive easily without having that much of an online presence. It's interesting also to have a look then how this level of digitalization changes over time, depending the role of the party. So we already seen that some parties in government have changed their mind about how much they empower their members and things like that. So, but yeah, it's worth to have a close look to see what's happening.
Thank you. Thank you, Patricia. We have a question from Pete from the public. You can raise your hand and make your question. And so we'll listen to Pete and the answer to Pete's question and see if there are more questions. And I have one too. Pete, I leave you the floor.
Well, thank you. Thank you. Very, very interesting topic and very interesting presentation. And of course, it is very privileged to have produced something prior to the pandemic and have the opportunity to revisit it. And I'm thinking also of a book that was published very opportunely prior to the pandemic, which is Shoshana Zuboff's work on surveillance capitalism, which I think came out in 2019. And she'd already been heavily covered, I think, in Germany in the preceding years, and her notion of not so much the distribution of power, a kind of I guess sort of zero sum sort of Marxian notion in many ways, but also the depletion of human power through surveillance and digitization, which I think is a very powerful idea. The idea that, yes, power is not being distributed so much as depleted on the part of people. And I wonder if you have any comments with relation to that.
Giulia, Patricia, who wants to answer? Or both of you?
As you wish. Well, very quickly, I think this idea, I have to say, I know the book, Surveillance Capitalism. I haven't read it yet, but I bought it. It's on my to-read list for the summer. So not having read the book, but just heard of it, I think that this concept might be mirrored in a concept that we apply, but also we do not invent, in the sense that comes from the book of Paolo Gerbaudo, also on Digital Party, which was published 2018. It comes from another perspective than ours, but still try to analyze what's happening in political parties concerning digital transition. And he is talking, he used the concept of pseudo-participation and insists on the idea of plebiscitarian participation. So what looks like empowerment, what looks like decentralization of power through digital technologies, but actually in the end is a very little power that is distributed to the grassroots of political organization thanks to digitalization. So it's true that as any kind of aspect from a party politics perspective, so not really on digital politics, but coming from a party scholar perspective, every kind of innovation in the organization of party and their structures can be seen as a tool for strengthening the party leadership or for really involving the party grassroots. And digitalization is treated exactly as any other tool that has been introduced before to that sense. So in some cases, the type of participatory platform that are used are a way to really involve other actors, supporters, voters, members in internal functioning and decision making. But in most cases, it's a case of pseudo participation. So it's really little power, mostly a marketing strategy, let's say, rather than actual devolution of powers to the lowest organizational strata of the party. Patricia.
Yeah, I think so. I agree with Julia's assessment on it, and I think it depends on each political party. I don't think we can generalize in the sense that all political parties will try to even centralize or to gain more control through how they frame the digital organization and sell it as this pseudo participation. So we cannot assume all parties' aim will be that one. I think also it depends on one level, because I imagine that at maybe at the lower level, if this is used at local level, you can have a lot of decision and actually use it as an empowerment tool for the parties, and then parties might benefit from this digital environment. But maybe at the national level, also in terms of organizational management, it might not be possible to take into account that many views. And the thing is that it could be the case that a lot of the members agree on what they want from the party, but it could be also the case that all of them are in disagreement, and how you handle that could be a problem. So organization, big organizations, I'm not sure how much is on their interest to allow very high levels of participation. And it's the same like when parties are in government and they need to decide or take certain political decisions, they often use, if they wanna claim that they are consulting the membership, questions might be phrased in certain ways so they ensure that the outcome is what they wanted in the first place. And they might use these online tools just as a way to add legitimacy to their own decisions. Or it also depends on the internal powers within the organization. So if the leader has a lot of support at the membership level, the leader might be more keen to use the digital option just to phrase the question, because they know that at the membership level, they will get the response they are looking at. And if this was maybe discussed offline at the different organizational levels, the outcome could be different, or they could be more challenged. So it really depends on how the internal distribution of power within the organization is, and especially I think the level of power, but also popularity of the leader among the members might influence what use they make of the digital tools in the end. But yeah, I hope we provide an answer that makes sense.
yes, great, thank you.
And by the way, I just wanted to add that there's a recent paper from one of the author of the chapters in our book, Isabel Borucki, which just has been published in Frontiers in Political Science, on how party members in Germany perceive digitalization. So I think my knowledge, this is one of the first paper in which survey data allow to see what's the perception of digital transition that is decided by the party lead by party members. So I haven't read it entirely yet, but maybe I can put the link in the chat. It's, I think, one of the few, I haven't seen any other paper so far, maybe I missed it, but that actually studies how, asks the members, what do you think about digitalization of parties? Do you feel involved? So it's the first one that actually answer the question that was mentioned by Patricia before. Thank you.
Do we have more questions from the public? Fabio.
Hi, hello, thank you. Hello, Patricia, hello. And Giulia. And thank you for the book. Just one quick question. Do you think we can speak about digital parties anymore? So as a different type of party, or it's a digitalization process? So, and it could explain also the difference between how digitalization is implemented in different parties, as they just mirror how the party is organized offline, if you want. Just that. Thank you.
Patricia, do you want to? Or I can answer. I have my opinion.
I don't think we can talk about digital parties. And I don't think that, let's rephrase. I'm sure there are some parties that can be categorized as digital parties and that they meet the criteria of the different authors that establish different categories of what a digital party is or not, because there is also no one single category identifying. There are different typologies and different aspects considered. But to the extent that all political parties have digitalized their organization, even if it's one or few aspects of it, using digital parties won't give us anything new to distinguish political parties. Now, I always think that we need to use labels if they allow us to distinguish across different types of parties. Since we are observing digitalization pretty much everywhere, I'm not sure what use we could make or I could make. But if someone can convince me we can make use, I'm happy to use the label. But yeah.
Thank you, Patricia. And just to complete what you say, because I totally share your point of view. I think there's an evolution of our work, in the sense that when we met in December 2018 for the first workshop of presentation of the first draft of the chapters, actually the workshop was called the Cyber Party. So we try to use the ideal type and apply it to contemporary cases. And while working on the rise version of the chapters, we realized that that actually didn't make sense anymore, but we cannot talk anymore about one model that can be applied, because this was becoming a broad transformation, that the only thing we could do is just try to measure this digital transformation in parties. But there's no point anymore to talk about an ideal type, because any party has at least one facet that is entirely or at least partially online. So it's becoming, let's say, the fourth facet of party, from the party on the ground, central office, public office, and online. But this online dimension is transversal to the other three, so it's not a separate one. So
Do we have more questions? No. Well, so I'll make one. I have a question quite similar to Pete's, but with less focus on party members. I think the book is very challenging to think party organization in Latin America, which is quite different from what you describe in Europe. With the issue we have here, in particular in Chile, of the disconnection of parties from civil societies and all the issue of the reconnection with territories and all that we're discussing now in Chile. I know you focus mainly on the organizational consequences of digitalization. But what happens with the social consequences? Would you say that digitalization tends to deepen the gap between civil societies and parties? I know there is a reconnection, a kind of a natural reconnection with people who are connected and who use social media. But I was wondering what happened at the local level, how it could help to reconnect parties with their traditional role, the linkage role you mentioned in the last slide of your presentation. I had those doubts and questions while I was reading the book and listening to your presentation. I don't know if you have some elements you could share about that.
So it's true that we don't study with that much detail the social aspect or the linkage to civil society organizations. And it's probably because most of the people involved are party scholars and party organization or come from this party organization or party membership strands. But this is also the same with the linkage or the debate of party decline and how parties are detached from society. And this, you have these experiences that they are not that able of recruiting new members, or that they are not able to engage with even traditional organizations. For instance, trade unions that used to be pillar organizations with social or social democratic parties, they don't have the same strong ties that they used to have in the past anymore. And to be honest, I'm not sure how digitalization could help, or I'm a bit pessimistic on that sense, thinking that it will worsen, because it is focused on engaging either members or supporters, but it is focused on trying to create this individual linkage. It is me as individual, I have this linkage with the organization, but it doesn't give opportunities for factionalism or for intergroup organizations to interact online, at least with what we or what I have seen so far. So that I'm not very optimistic about how it could work out, to be honest.
Yeah, and honestly, just to give a little example on this, beyond the presence of parties and particularly party candidates or more visible party elites on social media, especially during electoral campaign, most of voters or citizens, even more general, are completely oblivious of what happens in terms of digitalization of party. They are not involved, they do not interact. These kind of tools are not, at least for what we've seen, effective in connecting with the broader population as they are conceived and implemented right now. And for example, you might have seen there have been the French presidential elections, and we have done a little exit poll survey here in Lille, and in Roubaix, so it's in a nearby city, and we added a few questions on to what extent the voters have seen or interacted with posts or information by the candidates on social media in the weeks coming up to the election. And the share of responses of real actual voters in a representative sample of the polling station that actually have seen or reacted, but even just seen the electoral campaign material of parties online is minimal.
Okay.
So, and parties have spent interesting amounts of money on digitalizing their campaign in France. I'm not saying that the situation here in Lille can be generalized to the rest of France, and we are conducting other surveys online by phone right now to check these results. But what we've seen on this very specific field, where actually the broad population is not really engaged with this kind of tools that are created by parties.
Okay, thanks. Karina?
Yeah, I was just thinking about, we have talked about parties as campaigners and parties as channels of participation, membership organizations. And I'm thinking, if we go back to the ultimate role of parties, ultimate function, it's to nominate candidates. So I was just thinking whether you've got any thoughts on to what extent parties are actually able to recruit and train potential candidates, potential office holders with the digital tools that they're applying currently.
Patricia, do you want to say something, or shall I say?
So to be honest, I think most of the training is still happening offline. And I think a lot of political parties, there are some political parties that they will have this training program that they are creating, and they might use the platform to advertise them, to recruit and to use them. But I think most of the training ends up happening later on offline. They might have some resources available, but I think when it comes to training, it tends to be done offline or in this type of like summer camps or these kind of like retreats where you go. But I've seen it advertised in different party websites. So definitely they are using it as a way to show all the things that they offer. And also it's one of the benefits of being a member. You are a member, not only thinking about being a candidate, but you're going to receive different types of training, and that's one of the options. So parties here in the UK, several of them have as one of the benefits of being a member, it will be advertised different training programs, not necessarily to become a candidate, although most of it are tailored to that. So.
Yeah, and if I can follow up on that, for what we've seen looking at the intranets, so internal platforms of, in the book in particular, of French and Spanish, but also Italian parties, there's always a section of the internet that is reserved for educational or technical training programs for running in the election, but mostly for once you are elected or once you're officially a candidate, how you run your campaign or how to be an expert on, I don't know, the kind of field that is covered by your parliamentary committee, whether at local, regional or national level. So most of the training is done once the candidate is selected, which makes sense in the sense that, of course, they cannot offer free webinar to whoever wants to take them just for by applying to be a candidate. But this kind of affordance is present in many intranets or internal platform of parties. And by the way, if you can just add one technical point, we had many more pictures of the intranets and internal platforms of parties, but we ran into a legal issue just weeks before the publication, before the book was sent to the press, because actually the publisher realized that we needed a written consent by each party, and we managed to get for some of them, for example, for La France Insoumise, but not for other. So we have lost like half of the pages of the book, which were actually nice picture of what actually are the affordances of actually how the interface look on those intranets.
Fabio? You had another question?
Just one thing, building on the question Karina was asking, coding this project we are doing with Giulia, I was called in a British party, an Irish party, and what they said, you could be a candidate, you could propose yourself via internet for being a candidate, and they explained all the steps you have to do, and at the end they said, if you are a winning candidate, the party will run an internet check of your social networks by a private enterprise. I don't have now the data, I could check it. And I think that's interesting because maybe they teach you how to use them, but they also want to be aware that how did you use them. So, and I think that's interesting because then you see, when you see a new politician, the first thing journalists and the media do is check what he said 25 years ago, not because there was no Twitter there, but 5 years ago, 6 years ago. And I think it was interesting. I don't know how many parties do that. I guess, I don't know. Just was that.
Well, I don't see any more question. And the time is running out. So in the name of CPS board, I want to thank Giulia, Patricia, Karina, for their participation, the audience for questions, and all the institutions which made this possible. And see you on next CPS Talks with Authors session. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.